it's always, it always brings a tear to my eye. It's wonderful. I had a guy called Booba rang up one day. The town I lived down there, they do good works down in the Gambia, and Booba was living down there where my mum went down there to do some irrigation thing. They had this thing where they plant the crops and they'd all die. So they just build this little wall, like 6-inch wall, and keep the soil in, keep the rain from washing and stuff like that. That's the kind of thing she was doing. She, I think she dug a well, you know. Anyway, Booba rang up and said that, I haven't told this. It's usually a down the pub thing. Anyway, I feel kind of at home. he rang up and said, I would like to come to see your mother. And she's buried in the garden at home, so I wanted to come see the grave. And I said, fine, you're welcome, come along. And he came and he did his stuff over at the grave. And he came back crying his eyes out. And he said, you're my mum, she's amazing, you know. I said, yeah, I know. And he said, when she was with us in the Gambia, I was studying. My mother and father were dead. And I had 7 brothers and sisters, and I'm the oldest, and I had to look after them. But I was studying. And I spoke to her mother, and I told her I must give up my studies to look after my brothers and sisters. And sorry, shouldn't do this really. He said she gave me money, and she said you must finish your studies. You must. And now I am an optician for 140,000 people. And I'm the only man with a car for 40 miles. And that was the kind of the most tangible little miracle she performed, you know, with the result you could see. But the kid she looked at was a junior school headmistress and teacher before that. But the people that she interacted with, the people she worked with, she was good. She was good. She had a special something. Anyway. Sorry about that. Sometimes when we go, there's a family, you know, to places. And a few years back, we took my grandpa halfway down France to visit the places that he worked at in the 50s. And so, in the car with him, he was 92, my son was 9, and me, my wife. But my mum wasn't there, as you know, she was already gone. So it was a kind of a poignant trip with the gap in the generations there. My grandpa was well aware of this. Anyway, as older folks do, he was downloading his hard drive on us and deleting old data he didn't need anymore. So he went through all the files, he got the Aesop's Fables out in Latin and delivered them to us, which I presume was the last time he would do that. The incident. He was just lightening the load, you know.
Yeah,
that's awesome.
Yeah. Problem with
that. She just wanted to.
So we started telling tales, and he, I fucked this up royally. I got too emotional. It was an amazing trip, I would like to say, because whilst me and all the uncles and aunties in the convoy were wandering around, gawping like tourists at all the buildings he was pointing out, he was in a wheelchair, and my son, who was 9, was at eye level with him for the whole weekend. So they had real connection for those 3 or 4 days. It wasn't like the normal, you know, at Christmas. Thank you very much for the money you sent for me. It was actual, real connection, which is valuable in this day and age. And of course, it's all of our time's limited, but it was a precious weekend. It was great for them. My grandpa, he told us lots of secrets. He told us, actually, finally told the family what he did. What he did was he made this machine that calibrated all the machines that were down the Iron Curtain in missile silos, and they brought their machines in Ipcrest file, raincoats, in false briefcases, and got their machines calibrated against his, so that HQ knew that the missiles were pointed at Moscow and not Moffat. Thank you. I say muscle brother. But my mum was missing, so he told some stories about her too. And he told this story of her as a teenager going to the local bar, cafe, coming back with 2 Dutch lads and a case of beer as a 14-year-old in, you know, 58 or whatever it was. Which, you know, knowing her as a pillar of the community, as she became, it was great to hear this rock and roll story. You know, this was gone 9 o'clock at night. So they went to the top of the clock tower and rang the bell in the clock tower, trying to wake everyone up in this sleepy French village. I saw this picture when he told that story of the moon reflecting off the bell and shining a beam of light down on the cobbles below. That's what I saw. I imagined the bell like a good bomb. We did see it later in the trip, and it was like a little bit of a letdown. I kept the vision with me, and I took it home until I saw this Brian Cox documentary about the Big Bang. I take it there's no creationists in tonight. So I think we can all agree that the Big Bang happened 13.8 billion years ago. No, you're not agreeing. But what astounded me is that, well, it's Brian Cox's assertion, which I'm happy to go along with, that they are measuring photons from the Big Bang 13.8 billion years ago, hitting the Earth now today. You can do that. And that astounded me, and I got all cosmic. Plus, the vision of the light hitting the bell, I thought, fuck. So, the photons in the light beam coming off the bell are still going out into the universe. That moment is still happening, man. And the sound waves in that bell, their laughter, their voices are still, they're dissipated, they're still probably in our atmosphere, stratosphere, out there. They wouldn't make it to space, sound waves, I don't think, would they? They might do. But the light will. It'll be out there. So every moment with any light is always going to be. So all time really is now. Now is the beginning of all time. Well, it was, and now it's now. But no, that's now. Don't matter how fast you go.
No, you're talking
that. Yeah, I am talking that, right. We read the Hobbit when I was 9 together. We read it together, and the subtitle of the Hobbit is "There and Back Again." So I put that in. That was a moment. Yeah, but this is then. That was now. Then, but it's gone now. That's probably the weirdest and worst introduction to any song I've ever delivered. So thanks for your good pass. Willing me on. What the fuck is going on?